Basketball is my favorite sport.
Welcome all the sports fans to another edition of Around the Rim. I am your host, the Dudster, Nesta Dudley, along with Minister Bernard Stroud, coach of the Lakers. Minister Bernard, welcome to have you back again, buddy.
How are you? How you doing?
Can I say buddy or brother or?
Just brother.
Brother. Minister Bernard, everything is really purple and gold in the Lakers camp. The Lakers is on a mission to right what they feel as though was a wrong from a season agone. Last season, the whole city of Malden wanted to see Bullets versus Lakers. One errant game-affecting call that took the game out of the players' hands into officials' hands.
It was errant, in your opinion.
In the officials' hand, if I was acknowledging what he said something, I would answer that. And that changed the game. And the Bullets, Lakers were denied. But this year, Minister Bernard, we could see Bullets, Lakers in the big dance.
There is a very good chance that it might happen. And to tell you the truth, I'm thrilled about the prospect that is going on. But we still have 7 games to go. So right now, we are trying to just take each game one at a time. And wait till the end of the season and see where we fall.
Lakers so far, Minister Bernard, has one loss. And that lone loss had come at the hand of your second favorite nephew, if he ranks that high, Bernardo Stroud.
Yeah.
And those Lakers, Javon Walcott, man, you call coconut.
Yes. The game that they, I think, the Lakers gave away. I think that Bernardo, which I call Sticks and Coconut, they knew that we had the game in hand. But that's how it is sometimes. You do so much, but at the end, things slip away. My philosophy is that you put a team away as quick as you can, because if they're close in the fourth quarter, anything can happen, and something did happen. The Lakers lost. But fortunately, last week, the Lakers revenged, and that was a sweet victory for Beanie Amos, my favorite nephew, because after the Lakers lost to the Hawks, I'm told that my nephew got on the phone to call one of my ex-ball players, which is Magic, the coach of the Celtics, to tell him how to beat the Lakers. And I think the following week we played the Celtics, and I went over to Magic and said, what he told you didn't work, did it? Because we whooped up on them. So, Bernardo, you got to go back to the drawing boards. And, yes, Beanie Amos can win without me.
Beanie has been coaching in this league for 19 years. So, and Beanie, I watched that game, Minister Bernard, and Beanie didn't do his usual antics on the sideline to try to get the other coaches to get a T, although there was times when Bernardo Stroud and Javon Walcott was on the floor, and Beanie didn't mention it to the ref. They're on the floor, hoping to draw the T that way. But Beanie didn't do the usual antics, only because Beanie was aware of that phone call. Beanie was aware of the conversation that you told him that you had with Bernardo, and Beanie's mission was to beat those boys and beat those boys badly.
Beanie did, I take my hat off to him, but he showed a lot of class in this. I wasn't there to see the game, but I saw it on tape, and I saw his antics on the sidelines, and he showed a lot of class. I know him to jump up and hoop and holler and do his sidekicks, but he showed a lot of class. He was there for all business, and that's what it's all about.
Now, in this season, I've said it a couple of times, what kind of season are we in when the Lakers beat the Bullets? It was the second game, Minister Bernard. Lakers were 1-0, Bullets was 1-0, and the Lakers beat the Bullets for the first time in 4 years, Minister Bernard.
I think that was a good win. I want to dispel the mist that I'm only the spiritual advisor. People think I'm coaching, but it appears that, and maybe sometimes that I do, but maybe that was the divine intervention at that time, that the Lakers beat the Bullets, because it had been a while. But I think that was a game that solidified Beanie Amos' coaching ability. I think he did a great job, And I think that gave the Lakers, the people that had been on there for a couple of years, they gave them some confidence to let them know that they could beat the Bullets, that the Bullets didn't always have our number.
You go down the Lakers roster, Minister Bernard. Rashad Langston, Fritz Vilsaint, Brendan Berger, Jeremy Rocker, Sean Fitzpatrick, Stanley LaForest, Andy Robinson, Steve Ward, Fred Raymond, Josh Gomez. This squad, Minister Bernard, not that much different from last year's squad, but it seems that this, as far as talent-wise, with the exception that this squad obviously has 7 victories under their belt at the halfway point, 8 games, whereas last year's squad at this time had already lost to the Bullets a couple of times and the Hawks once, either that or the Hawks twice and the Bulls once. Last year's squad only lost 4 games, swept by the Bullets, swept by the Hawks. What are the differences between this squad, Minister Bernard, and last season's squad?
It starts from the top, and I would give my props to Jeremy Rocker. He is a very good ball player, but I had a talk with him, and I told him you're only as good, a good ball player will make his team better. Plus the addition of Steve Ward, Brendan Berger, and our diamond in the rough, Fred Raymond. We have
a who's a senior. You only have this one senior,
but he has a lot of potential. He's very smart. He just have to get a little bit more playing time on his belt, and he's going to be a very good ball player. We have some returning guys, Vilsaint, which I call him a man child. He's very well and may be the strongest person in this league.
Davis thinks he's that Fritz is 5 pounds overweight. Do you agree or disagree?
I don't. No, I don't. You know, I'm partial to healthy people. But he has to learn how to do the things that he has to play with the big man mentality instead of the little man mentality. You have Sean who has come into his own, but he's still, like always, he needs to get a little tougher. And if they learn from every game that they play, win or lose, coming into a playoff, they'll be a better team.
Lakers 7-1 have beaten the Bullets, lost to the Hawks once. You have another team out there, Bernard, the Celtics, who Magic thought he knew how to beat the Celtics after talking to Bonaco. This Celtic team, Minister Bernard, hot and cold, 500 ball. Can this Celtic team hang on and make it to the Madness? Both myself and Brad with Benton predicted that the Celtics wasn't going to the Madness. I personally predict the Sixers to take that fourth slot. Sixers is a dangerous team. I don't know if they can do it right now after this weekend. If they don't win a couple of games this weekend, they're mathematically out of it. So I don't think it's going to be the Sixers. But in your opinion, can the Celtics obtain that fourth slot with the Sonics and Kings, both 3-5, nipping on their heels?
The Celtics, from somewhere down the line, the two teams that are in front of them, they're going to need to win one. And if they're not playing as a unit, and if Magic doesn't have the right clientele in there at the times when he need them in there, it's going to be tough. But that fourth spot, it is you have 2 or 3 teams that are nipping on their coattail. So it's right now, if the Celtics play 500 ball, it might not be enough for them to get in, because you have the Kings, you have the Sixers and the Sonics who are right on their coattail.
Now, when we talk about Magic, we always talk about Magic and the clientele and the lack of utilizing the clientele, lack of even knowing what clientele. We're not even sure if he even knows the clientele. And but we're going to get to that. But right now, that music you're hearing, Minister Bernard, is you're caught up in the MNBL web. It's the web time. So what the MNBL web is all about is that I have no more than 3 minutes to ask as many questions as I want. I can ask as little as 1. I can ask as many as 33 questions as long as I'm in the 3-minute time limit. Minister Bernard, you are officially caught in the MNBL web. You are obviously a man of God, a man of Christ. Do you say a prayer for your teams to win these games?
You know, it just so happened I was thinking about that question today, and I knew that you was going to ask me. I knew you was going to ask me that question. To dispel the myth, no. I do not look for victory. I do not pray for victory over anyone. I pray that the kids go out there to do their best, to leave everything on the court, and if they are able to look in the mirror and say, I've done all I could, if we lose, then that's okay. But I pray that they do their best and to keep from anyone getting hurt. But no, I don't pray for victory, no.
At the beginning of this question, you said that you knew I was going to ask this question. So this brings up a question I just thought of now. Do your butt cheeks get tight at the thought of sitting on the studios or around the rim?
No.
Okay.
It's so wet.
Minister Bernard, you are officially out of the web.
Thank you.
Magic and the clientele. We've all talked around, and it seems like Magic has a good squad. He has a fairly deep bench. But at times, ever since he's been head coaching for 3 years, I believe this is his third season, it just appears to myself and to Bradworth Benton that he doesn't put the right clientele on the floor. So I'm asking you, Minister Bernard, all of those years of tutelage under yourself and Beanie Amos, both as a player and as an assistant coach, did Magic skip the meetings when you guys went over clientele? I mean, what is it that Bernacco shows the puts clientele on his Hawks floor? It just seems like the Magic man doesn't put the clientele on his Celtic floor.
I think that the one thing that I've noticed about the Magic, what he's doing, is he's taking the whole burden and putting on himself. If people would realize, if they could go back some years, that Beanie Amos and myself, there were some coaches that they came to see us fight on the sidelines. Because
those days are long gone.
Because now we're on the same page. And Magic has to learn that he has another coach, another ball player that has played in this league, that has been playing basketball for a while, and he's a very good coach. So he has to confer with his coach and to realize that it's not all about him, that it's a team thing, even in coaching, that you need to confer with the other coach, because that's the key, is just togetherness.
And Cliff Williams won a title in the year 2000, so it's not like Cliff Williams
He's a very able coach, and he has a very basketball mind. And if Cliff wants to jump ship sometime and come to the Lakers, I welcome him.
An official proposal?
No problem.
Non-official proposal, because that would be called tampering there, Go Ref Go, and Minister Bernard does not tamper. He prays a lot, as we all should, but he does not tamper.
Absolutely.
But he does not tamper. I had this question, it was back in my head, and now, oh yeah, this is the question. You said that now you and Beanie Amos, after all these years, Beanie's been coaching for 19 years and you've been there right alongside of him. And I would say, roughly for the past 3 seasons, that you guys have been on the same page. So, how did it take 16 years to get to the same page? What happened after 16 years that you guys finally sat down and said, okay, it's going to go this way?
I don't think we ever came to that point, whether we sat down and talked about this is the way it was going to go. God does things in mysterious ways. So he calmed the storm that was on the sideline. So now we might disagree, but that's okay also. It's okay to voice your opinion. So we understand that I understand that he is the head coach, but he has put, it's like we are equal partners. That if I think that he had made a bad substitute, I will let him know. And most of the time we will sit and we will talk it out right then and there. And he agrees with what I say, because not to put a little stuff on mine, but I'm the one that taught him.
Go ahead, you can do this if you want. You can do that if you want. Minister Bernard, we look at this Bullets roster. You're facing this Bullets one more time in the regular season. We're not talking big dance. We're not talking madness amplification. We're talking one more time. The Lakers are facing the Bullets, I believe, not this weekend, but possibly the next weekend. Mike Fitzgerald, that guy named Gus Cognata, Sam Renee, Michael Bonaparte, Jimmy Dean, Darrell Downtownson, Victor Tran, Nick Hooper, Justin and Josh, the Gillis twins. I'm sure yourself and Beanie would love to sweep the Bullets in a regular season. I have to go back into the records to see when the last time that was done. Possibly 1996 might have been the last time that the Lakers swept the Bullets in the regular season. What you have to do to keep that Bullet team in check? You have that guy named Gus Cognata and Mike Bonaparte now, within these past several weeks, playing on the inside. They're looking inside first. They're playing inside out. You know about that because you preach that. This team now has probably become more dangerous as a defending Neighborhood League champs because they are playing inside out.
They're playing a more controlled, patient game, and the Lakers will have to be pretty darn near perfect in everything they do, minimize the turnovers, hit their free throws, play good hard-nosed defense in order to beat the Bullets the way they're playing right now. It will be a tough fought game. As always, I would pick the Lakers to win, but the game could go either way. They're a well-coached team from day one. Steve Wright, a good friend. And they're playing very good right now. The way that I would play the Bullets is almost a carbon copy that we've done before. The Lakers have always been a running team. And we
can't, since day two.
we can't play anyone else's game. We run until we can't run anymore. And then we run again. So that is the only way that I can combat that physical attributes that Cognato and Bonnepain has, even with Dean.
Now, Minister Bernard, Lakers are 7-1. The Bullets are 8-1. The Lakers are in the second slot. But for all intents and purposes, Minister Bernard, the Lakers are in first place. And whoever would win that, it appears, because anything can happen. We still have half a season to go in this journey to March Madness. But it appears that whoever wins that game, the next meeting between the purple and the blue, that team is going to get the number one slot. That team's going to finish first place. And how huge is it this season to finish in first place?
It is first place. It's almost a must. But I forget about the 7-1. And now I'm focusing on the last six games. I forget about the other record. It's trying to go at least 5-1 or 6-0. If we can do that, we'll be all right. But the first place, it is something that we're all shooting for, but it's not to say that if you don't come in, you won't make it to the final, but you'll just have two hard-fought games. But who knows? You know, anything could happen. Lakers can falter. Any team can lose on any given day.
With that said, my main man, Wallace Wiggleworth, is telling me that Go Ref Go is on the money, and we're going to go to the Rollins. So right now, I'm going to apologize to the Baldwin sports fans because I do not have the traditional Rollins with all those highlights because the Dudster got a little cold yesterday, still fogged up and clogged up today. So we're going to go over the scores. I'm going to tell you who did what.
So I'm tipping up here to Buck Tussle, Tennessee, huh?
Yes. So Go Ref Go, kick it. Last week's games, February 12th. The first game, Sonics, 3 points better than the Celtics, 50-47. Gibson led the Celtics with 14 points. Kelly led all scores with 18 points. The Sonics improved to 3-5. The Celtics dropped to 3-4, first time under 500 this year. Next game, Lakers-Pistons, Lakers 69, Pistons 38. Michael Twisted Steel led the Pistons with 12 points. Jeremy Rocker led all scores with 29 points. The Lakers improved to 6-1. Pistons dropped to 1-6. Third game this past Saturday, Hawks-Bullets. Bullets 62, Hawks 49. Billy Lou led the Hawks with 15 points. Jimmy Dean led all scores with 26 points. The Bullets improved to 8-1. The Hawks dropped to 6-2. First game Sunday, Kings-Pistons. Kings 53, Pistons 46. Danny Suter led the Kings with 17 points. Cliff Hilaire-Rius led all scorers with 18 points. He represents the Pistons. That has fallen to 1-7. Kings improved to 3-5. Second game on Sunday, Sixers-Celtics. Celtics back on the winning track, 59-47. Anthony Papagallo led the Sixers with 14 points. Adler Sertl led all scorers with 15 points. The Celtics improved, got back to 500, ball 4-4. The Sixers dropped to 1-7. And the third game Sunday, Lakers-Hawks 71-55. Rico Omida led the Hawks with 25 points. Jeremy Rocker led all scorers with 34 points. The Lakers improved to 7-1. The Hawks dropped to 6-3. That's what happened this past weekend. Now for our weekly Around the Rim Award. So let's kick it. Player of the Week this past week. Repeat Player of the Week, Jeremy Rocker. The past couple of weeks, he has just been blowing up. He has just been averaging high 20s on Saturday, low 30s on Sundays. Coach of the week, Beanie Amos of those Lakers. The Lakers right now on a 4-game winning streak. And Beanie Amos with class and authority, showing the tough love to Bonaco Stroud. And Minister Bernard, I almost replayed when Bonaco Stroud was dancing when he was 12 years old because I understand that you missed that show. But Coach of the Week, Beanie Amos. Team of the Week, giving it up to the Lakers, again, on a 4-game win streak, technically in first place, but situated in second place because they have one game less under their belts. And Woo of the Week, I like this Woo of the Week. Woo of the Week goes to Rashawn Vaughn. Why? Because Rashawn Vaughn showed the epitome of selflessness. There has been a trade that's been made this season, the MNBL. It has been made between the Sixers and the Sonics. Adrian McKenzie left the Sonics camp, going to the Sixers camp. Now, Adrian McKenzie, if you look at him, he's a thicker brother. Needed a uniform. All the extra uniforms were mediums. So Commissioner Ken Mazonson went up to one Sixer player, and we're not going to put anybody out. So we're not going to give that player's name. But Lindbergh Okerberg refused to give up his jersey, and he was wearing an XL, which is a dress on him. Then he went to Rashawn Vaughn, who is a returner, was wearing 3, Allen Iverson. He gave up his number for Adrian McKenzie, and he took number 6. Ken Mazonson say, hey, number 6 is Dr. J. But Rashawn Vaughn, Dr. J, Dr. Phil were the same people anyway. But anyways, Rashawn Vaughn, act of selflessness, this woo is for you. Woo! Now on to the official MNBL standings. Once again, I don't care who you talk to, what you read. If it don't match this, it just ain't official. Bullets on top of the league right now, 8-1, followed by the Lakers, 7-1. Hawks 6-3, Celtics playing 500 ball, 4-4, followed by the Sonics, Kings, both those teams 3-5, both those teams on a 1-game win streak. Pistons 1-7, losers of 2, and the Sixers in butt naked last, 1-6. You like that, huh? And now on to Go Refs Go favorite category. There's your favorite category, Dirty Dozen. These are the boys that are most likely to take your head off if you come into that lane. Randy Omida, that goes back to 99, his older brother for the Celtics. Rico Omida on top of the league right now, the dirtiest dozen of them all, 34 fouls. Ray Charles, 30 fouls. Yeah, Jamie Guest, 29 fouls. Ken LaFosse, 29 fouls. Minister Bernard, 3 of the top 4 slots are Hawks. So what is Bonaco Stroud and Jovan Walcott teaching those boys in that Hawks camp?
They're playing Matador defense. If you would notice, the Hawks, they're always slapping, they're always grabbing at the ball in the air. They remind me of Deion Sanders. Deion Sanders was a heck of a cover guy, but he wasn't going to attack you. He would move out of your way. That's what the Hawks remind me of.
Followed by Sanchez, Dean, Berger, Hilaire, Vaughn, Olivier, Gibson, and Gillis. And now in honor of February is Black History Month, we're going to have a Black History Moment where we drop some knowledge. Black History Moment.
It's supposed to be next week's games.
Well, whatever. You know I never get this right. We're going to do this first, then we'll do next week's games. Black History Moment, Elizabeth Taylor Greenfield, born 1809, died 1876, dubbed the Black Swan. She gained worldwide acclaim as a brilliant vocalist. Her 27-note range was hailed as astonishing. She gained her nickname for her moving and emotional performances during the era just before the Civil War. That was your Black History Moment. Go Ref Go, I'm sorry to do it to you. I like I said, I've been doing the show for 13 years. You think I know my own rundown by heart? I guess I don't. I'm thinking of 3 letters. Anyways, next week's games. Saturday, first game, Celtics, Bullets, followed by the Hawks, Sixers. Third game, Kings, Lakers. And in that first game between the Celtics and the Sixers, Bullets, is there any magic left? Sunday's
thinking
game?
Of 5 letters now.
Thinking of 5 letters. Sunday's game, which will be the 20th. First game, Sixers, Sonics. Second game, Pistons, Celtics. Third game, Hawks, Kings. It'll be Big Mac versus Bubba in that first game on Sunday. Back into the studios of Go Ref Go. Go Ref Go, how much time do we have? We have roughly 4 minutes.
You are exactly right.
You see, well, that makes up for missing my rundown.
There you go.
Minister Bernard, we have less than 4 minutes. Can you take us out of here in like a 1 to 2 minute prayer?
Yes, I can. We'll bow our heads. Eternal God, our Father, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. How wonderful that you are, O Heavenly Father. Father God, it is you who sits high and look low. You rule and you super rule this world. Father God, we understand that we can't do anything without you but fail. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your grace and mercy. We understand, Lord, that it was your grace and mercy that woke us up this morning. Lord, you touched each and every one with the finger of love, and you whispered into our ear, and you caused us to rise this morning. And Lord, as we arose this morning, we had full knowledge of our minds. When we looked in the mirror, we recognized the image that was staring back at us. Father God, we understand that there are those who wasn't able to see this day, Lord. And Lord, we just ask for a special blessing on their families. But Lord, we ask a special blessing on this program that has been in progress for 13 years. Lord, we pray that it will continue to grow in strength. We pray that the announcer will continue to be his same self. And Lord, we ask you a special blessing on him, on this network, on the camera crew, on the people who's in charge. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for the MNBL. For 20 years, Lord, you've watched over this league. It has prospered. It has grown through leaps and bounds. We thank you for the commissioner who had the vision enough to start this, Lord. And we thank you for the people who has been there since day one. We thank you for the Steve Wrights, the Beanie Amoses. We thank you for all those who have come through those doors, Lord. And we pray that it will continue to go, and it will give young men and young women a viable asset that during the winter months, so that they maybe have a physical things to do, and maybe they will learn something. Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings, but we thank you foremost for your Son, Jesus the Christ. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus. Let everyone say amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Minister Bernard.
You're welcome.
And with that, I just want to say buenas noches, hoochas cooches. I came in peace. I leave with love. This is for the red, the black, and the green, and I'll be seeing you at the games. We got to pray.
shit, start the count. Here we go.
That's why we pray.
Kicking back, keep these words we need to know.
That's why we pray.
Living high, living good, living low.
That's why we pray.
Take a minute, bust a breath, and you're good to go.
That's why we pray.
Oh yeah, we pray. We need to pray just to make it today. I said we pray. Oh yeah, we pray.
Somebody tell my mother I love her.